Welcome, everyone. Byron White here. Happy to be happy everyone could join us today in our 67th webinar series here at Writer Access. I'm happy to introduce Josh Bernoff. Josh, welcome.
Thanks. It's great to be here.
Josh joins us today as the chief troublemaker of WOBs, without bullshit is the correct pronunciation, so we've learned in the social sphere after some testing we did. Just on that side note, we were very concerned when we talked with Josh about using the title bullshit in a title for a webinar, and we fretted over it for a little while. But as it turns out, we have some stats that were quite interesting. We did some A-B testing for this promotion, and as it turns out, we had a 15% increase in clicks when we used the word bullshit versus BS, which is quite interesting, and that carried over to the conversions on 15% increase as well. We also had no spam complaints. We did have 7 people of the over 1,000 people signed up, and we sent this out to a couple 100,000 people that are opt-in subscribers with us. And only seven personal emails back from people that were slightly offensive. So a fairly small percentage of people were offended, perhaps, by this, or either that, or overcome by the overwhelming wealth of knowledge that Josh has for us today. Perhaps that's the reason that this was successful. I wouldn't disagree with that. I've known Josh for many years, like all of us on the line, as a major thought leader in the sphere, shall we say, and I greatly look forward to his presentation today. But first, 5 quick house rules, if you will, and certainly without any bullshit to stay in tune with. So I'll get right to this quickly and turn things over to Josh. First of all, everyone will receive a link to download the slide deck and a link to listen to the presentation that will be hosted on Writer Access for anyone to have a listen to in the future. Next, as mentioned, there's going to be this is of course recorded and it will be hosted, so you'll be able to click on the resource center on Writer Access to access it in the future, along with all of our other presentations we've done over the years. Please use chat to ask questions. Kate and I will be filtering through those and grouping those up and asking Josh some questions in the end. There will be some of my questions followed by some of the attendees that can chime in. Following the presentation, Josh will spend hopefully about 10 or 15 minutes answering all of our questions. Finally, please use the hashtag #WriteOn, and we'll be able to track things along. But without further bullshit, shall we say, please welcome Josh.
Hi, thanks very much. So this is a little bit about me. I've been a writer for 34 years, and my most popular book that I wrote with Charlene Lee was Groundswell, Winning in a World Transformed by Social Technologies. What I've been doing lately is blogging at withoutbullshit.com, a site that's been very popular and has gotten over 400,000 views in its first 3 months. We're now bumping up above 600,000. And as you can see, I'm also an avid bicyclist. I actually biked here from my home, took about 45 minutes today. I think we've got a poll to get started. Byron, you want to introduce this? Tell people how they can participate. Okay.
So this is Kate here. I just launched the poll for all of our attendees. The question is, which of the following time wasters annoys you the most? And select one of the following. Is it emails from colleagues that just don't get to the point? Jargon-laden websites and press releases, not being able to put your best idea into words effectively, the decline in the quality of online media, or none of the above, everything is awesome, just like what was at the Lego movie, everything is awesome. let's see, I've got about 50% of you guys have voted, and it's trickling in a tie between jargon-laden websites and not being able to put your best ideas into words effectively. I think that's my biggest time waster, trying to come up with the right words. So I'm going to close the poll since you guys have all voted now, and there you can see where you fall. Interesting results there.
Gee, no one thinks everything is awesome. At least people acknowledge there's a problem.
All right, on to you,
I didn't
Josh.
Vote, Josh. I didn't vote, so I would have been the one voting there. I'm a pure optimist. Besides, you're going to fix everything today. So from this moment forward, it's what I voted on.
Okay, excellent. All right, so why don't I get started here and talk about writing without bullshit. Now, the first thing I got to get out of the way is, no, I'm not just cursing to get attention. I have been interacting with writers and reading content online and everywhere else for decades now, and I have to say I just have become really frustrated at the fact that people cannot seem to express themselves in a bold, clear, and powerful way. And that's a shame for the writers out there, but it's even worse for everybody else who's in a position of attempting to consume content. So whether it's your email inbox that's full of irrelevant, challenging to get to the point kind of text, whether you're visiting somebody's website trying to figure out just what it is that they do, whether you're reading a news article and you say, what in the heck are they trying to get at here? People have just lost the art of getting to the point in a clear and powerful way. And I'm going to try and help solve that problem. But first, I'd like to introduce you to how that feels and maybe even measure it by showing you an email right here that a friend of mine received from a recruiter who was trying to recruit them. So you can see here it says subject opportunity. Well, all right, I'm excited already. Good morning. Our client is a newly funded startup focused on transforming real-time content at the intersection of community and commerce. They are assembling a high-level team, let's make sure we capitalize team, and are positioned to disrupt business models in the real-time video space with a fresh model and line of thinking not yet seen in the sector, and they are currently looking for a CTO to join the team. And then, of course, the requisite meaningless closing, I would love the opportunity to discuss the opportunity with you. So I'm not just railing against stuff like this, I'm analyzing it. And let's take a look here and see what's wrong with what you see here. First of all, the subject line, opportunity, is not something that you immediately want to open up and grab onto. It sort of doesn't mean anything. And in fact, there's a lot of words in here that don't mean anything. We can look at focused on transforming real-time content at the intersection of community and commerce. Well, that's definitely bullshit. We can definitely see that assembling a high-level team, that's good. I wouldn't want to join a place that's assembling a low-level team. And disrupting business models is something that's pretty common out there. So we'll gray those out. And also the fresh model and line of thinking not yet seen in the sector because, hey, I don't want to join a startup with stale thinking. And, of course, we can also disappear the good morning and I'd love the opportunity to speak with you. And what you end up with in this whole short email is that the only text worth paying attention to is newly funded startup, real-time video space, and looking for a CTO. This is pretty lame. And in fact, I invented a metric, not very sophisticated, but pretty simple, that allows you to measure just how lame stuff like this is. It's what I call the meaning ratio. Just take the number of meaningful words in something that you're reading and divide it by the total number of words. And based on what I grayed out here and what we just looked at, the meaning ratio of that email is 6%. That's really sad. That's, in fact, the lowest number that I've ever seen on anything that I've analyzed. So if you're writing stuff with a meaning ratio of 6%, you are offending your audience. You are wasting their time. Whatever message you imagine that you are communicating, the real message that you are communicating is, I don't care about your time. And I'm going to urge you to think very differently about your writing and what people read, whether it's an email that you're sending or a white paper that you're writing or a blog post that you're putting up, and adopt what I call the iron imperative. What's the iron imperative? Well, the iron imperative is that you must treat the reader's time as more valuable than your own. And when you internalize this concept, when this becomes the way you think about everything in writing, you're in a position to clear out all of that meaningless blather and actually tell people things that are useful for them to hear. In the case of this email, you could rewrite it like this. Hey, video models are broken. Want to fix them. All right, there's a subject line. that immediately will attract somebody who's interested in this kind of a thing, and the rest, they don't have to read it because you don't want them. I'm working with a newly funded startup. They think real-time video is an opportunity, but the rest of the world is doing it wrong, and they need a CTO. Interested? Call me. That's all the words you need to communicate something like this. That's writing without bullshit. So today I'm going to tell you a lot more about how you can actually put that principle into practice. You can obey the iron imperative. And I'll do that through three pieces. First of all, I'll talk about what is bullshit, because I do have a definition, and where does it come from? Why is there so much out there? What kind of writing stands out in a world filled with bullshit? And in particular, how can you and your writing stand out from that background of gray, meaningless text so that people will notice you and act on what you have to say? And I'll also talk about process, how you can write powerfully and effectively by setting yourself up to succeed as a writer. So let's start with this first question: what is bullshit and where does it come from? So my definition of bullshit is any content that does not effectively communicate its meaning. And that includes a whole variety of different types of meaningless crap. But if you want to know why we got here, you can take a look at how things have changed in the last 30 or so years. In 1980, everything or almost everything that you read was in print. And as a result, you had professional writers, editors, marketing copywriters, and executives who created content that went through a process to make sure that it actually did the job it was supposed to. We had print media with articles and ads in them. The articles were written by professional writers. The ads were written by professional copywriters. All of that went through professional editors. And that meant that when you picked up the newspaper or magazine, you were looking at content that had actually been vetted in some way. If you were reading a book, it had gone through a similar editorial process. And even direct mail pieces were written by professional marketing copywriters and edited by professional editors before they arrived in your mailbox. Even in the case of corporate communication, you had executives writing memos and policies, and while they may not have had a professional editor, what they did have was a secretary, and that secretary helped them to express themselves in ways that were actually clear and meaningful. What's changed since 1980 is that now we read almost everything on a screen, a piece of glass, your laptop, or your smartphone, and you can read a whole lot more that way, but it's much more difficult to read, and it tends to be generated in ways that don't have any editorial process. So if we look at print media in 2015, or the equivalent of print media, the websites from professionally produced content, you have the same articles and ads which go through an editorial process, although I think a lot of us would say that that process is a lot less rigorous than it used to be. But you've also got native ads, that is, ads that are masquerading as content. Those may or may not go through an editor. You have contributed content, articles that are contributed to fill in the spaces that they have to put in. And I can tell you from my personal experience of contributing content to a variety of publications that they never edit that stuff. And then, of course, you've got the comments from random people out there that don't go through any sort of editorial process. And that's the media, which is the best part. If you look at digital marketing, you've got brand sites, you've got email marketing, which may or may not get some sort of editing. Then you've got corporate blog posts, you've got social network posts from the company. All of this stuff being produced by relatively junior people, and most of it that doesn't get anywhere near enough scrutiny before it goes live. So is it all that surprising that it really is written in a way that isn't effective? And what I haven't even put on this chart is the email, the random emails you get from your colleagues, from your company, and from people in other companies, none of which goes through any sort of editorial process. So this creates a world in which we are all awash in bullshit, in meaningless, overwritten, jargon-laden crap that does not communicate effectively. This is not only a problem, it's an opportunity. It's an opportunity for you to write boldly and stand out from that gray background. People should read your emails and say, ah, this is somebody who's actually getting to the point and is not wasting my time. They can respond positively to clarity in your blog posts, tweets, your posts on Facebook if you're doing that for marketing purposes, anything that you write in marketing copy, reports for internal distribution. Why not impress people with how direct and to the point you are? White papers, press releases, all of this writing, it's possible to write boldly and stand out. I'll just say as an aside here that I just finished a tour of publishers in New York. My book, Writing Without Bullshit, they are evaluating right now. We'll probably be picking a publisher next week. And based on what I saw in talking to editors at some of the largest publishing companies in the world, they read what I proposed here and said, you have to publish this book because I have to send this to all of our authors so that they understand how to write without bullshit. It's that pervasive of a problem that even professional authors need help. Now, you might ask yourself, how did we get to this point? Why do people write this way? And there's a very simple answer, and that answer is fear. Fear is what generates bullshit. Fear of actually saying what you mean, fear of how people will react to it. The counterintuitive thing I can tell you, though, is that the more cowardly you are in terms of what you present, the more people are likely to be angry and annoyed at it. It's actually safer to say what you mean than it is to try and hide it in a cloud of bullshit. And this includes all sorts of habits that we have from fear that make writing weaker. Lame openers. People often sort of dance around a little bit before getting to the point, especially when trying to deliver bad news. And of course, that just infuriates people further to find out on paragraph 7 of the email that 2,000 of their colleagues are about to be laid off. You've got passive voice. Now, passive voice, English teachers have been railing against forever, but when you actually analyze it, the reason people write in passive voice is they're attempting to conceal whose responsibility it is to solve a problem. So passive voice is another way to frustrate your reader and generate that feeling that you're reading bullshit. You've got weasel words, qualifying words like very and often that people include to evade having to make firm statements about things, but again, make writing weaker. You've got jargon, like what we saw in that email that we just saw, that makes it much harder to figure out what's going on. And then a couple of things that people might not think of, over-collaboration, that is getting all of your colleagues to weigh in and then putting all of their comments in, which makes things a lot weaker. And overwriting. There's no penalty for writing long versus short, except, of course, the penalty that comes from people getting frustrated at the fact that you put them through all of that reading effort. And on a screen, that's a very challenging thing for them to have to do. So let's solve the problem. Let's figure out what kind of writing stands out in a world filled with bullshit. I'm going to tell you how to do that, and then I'll move on to what techniques you can use to actually become effective at this yourself. And if there's one thing that you can do more than any other, it's this. Write short. Write things as briefly as possible. Now, people hear that. They even embrace that. But it's not something that they can figure out how to do. The trick to writing short is to cut stuff that doesn't belong. It sounds very intuitive, but it means that when you write, you need to go back and look at it and then ask yourself, what sentences, words, paragraphs can we get rid of? Let me give you an example here, and this example comes from Inovalon, which is a medical technology company, and I was on their website. This is their Who Are We page. And they say, Inovalon is a leading technology company that combines advanced cloud-based data analytics and data. You know what? I'm not going to subject you to reading this whole thing. You get the idea. But imagine for a moment that it's your job to write this. Can we figure out why this is so long? Well, let's look at some of the things that need to be deleted. First of all, there's passive voice. Now, there's not that much passive voice in here, but in particular, there's this sentence right in the middle of it. Enovalon's unique achievement of value is delivered through the effective progression of turning data into insight and insight into action, registered trademark. So what does that mean? Who's delivering it? How are they delivering it? The reason that that is a lot weaker than it could be is because it doesn't tell you who's responsible for actually succeeding here. So that ought to be in the active voice. And in general, how I feel about passive voice is there are places where passive voice makes sense, but every time you use the passive voice, you should ask yourself, is this here for evasion or is it more effective in passive voice? And I'd say about 90% of the time, you'll find that you want to get rid of that passive voice sentence and make it active. Excuse me. The second thing here is weasel words. So Enovalon is a leading technology company. It has advanced cloud-based data analytics. It has achieves meaningful insights. It has an effective progression. These words don't actually mean anything. What's the difference between a leading technology company and any other technology company? God forbid we should have cloud-based data analytics that are not advanced. And of course, the king of all weasel words is deep. Whenever you see deep, you're
Hey, Josh, if you are still there, we're having a little bit trouble hearing you.
Okay, I will.
Oh, here we go. Now you're back.
Okay,
I don't know what
all
happened.
Right.
Keep doing okay. What you're doing.
Okay, I'll keep going here. So as I said, deep right. is perhaps the king of the weasel words here. And look at the number of weasel words in here. Once we remove these, you're going to be much better off. Finally, let's take a look at jargon. This is filled with jargon. Intervention platforms, integration technologies, seamless end-to-end capabilities. Now, jargon has its place. If you are a technical person speaking with other technical people about a technical topic, you don't necessarily want to use imprecise words. But in general, jargon is something that people use to puff themselves up. It makes things more difficult for the reader. So if you believe the iron imperative that your time is more valuable, that the reader's time is more valuable than yours, you want to avoid jargon. This could be much better and much simpler, and so I rewrote it. If we remove all of this meaningless stuff, you find out that the meaning ratio here is 41%, which is not as bad as that email, but it's still pretty sad. And then if we rewrite it, you get this. Enovalon has more insight into health data than anyone else. We analyze that data and apply the knowledge to help you improve care options, reduce costs, and improve compliance. Now do you know what they do? Yeah. And we can know who their customers are. We help hospitals, doctors, insurance payers, and patients. We identify gaps in care, quality, and data integrity and apply our unique capabilities to resolving them. Much more meaningful and much shorter and to the point. And I want to point out one other thing here, which is that this is written using we and you and our. That makes it more connect better with the customers. So we're going to help you improve care options, et cetera. And by putting we in here instead of passive voice, the company actually takes responsibility for the things that it's supposed to do well. All right, let's move on now and talk about what are the qualities of this new way of writing. Well, it's short, but there's more to it than that. It also is clear. It values clarity over everything else. It's front-loaded. In a world where people are reading things on a screen, you need to get to the point instantly. If you do not tell them what they need to know right away, then they're going to skip and move on to the next thing. It uses we, I, and you. It uses bullets, graphics, and tables as tricks to help structure content to make it a lot easier to consume than you would if you were just reading prose. And it justifies things with examples and statistics that make them more believable. Here are the things that it does not include. It does not include passive voice. It does not include jargon. It does not include weasel words, and it doesn't include long sentences. Now, I want to point out one element of this, which is the idea of front-loading things, probably the most powerful difference in the way that things need to be done now versus what you're reading. I adhere to this principle myself on my blog. My principle on the blog is that when you read the title of my blog post and the first 50 words, you know right away what it's about. You can decide to read it or not read it, but you know right away what's it about. There's no poetic openings. We just get right to the point. For example, here's one of my most popular posts called How to Disagree with People. As you can see, it was shared over 1,000 times on Facebook. People on Facebook are beastly to each other. It's gotten worse since Ferguson, Charleston, and the recent Supreme Court decisions. I'm sick of it. I'd like to propose a way to fix it. Anybody confused about what this blog post is going to be about? So it doesn't start with some artistic flourish. It starts with, all right, this is what we're going to tell you today. Let's move on now to technique. How can you actually write powerfully and effectively? And in order to explain that, I want to explain how most writing actually happens today. It uses what I call the three P's process. So let's say you've got 3 weeks to write a piece of marketing copy, but this is the same whether it's a blog post or a white paper or a report. The first half of the time that you have before your deadline is spent on step one, which is procrastinate. And the reason that people procrastinate is because they go to start writing and they say, well, I don't have everything I need to write, so I can't write, so they go off and they do other things. They might be on Facebook, they might be doing something useful, but eventually the first half of the time goes by and they switch from procrastinate mode into the mode where the work really gets done, which is panic. So panic is, oh my gosh, I got to start writing now, and then they start flinging words down in an attempt to actually get something together that'll be useful. Of course, that's a first draft, and that first draft is what goes around and gets circulated because they don't have time for anything else. And if they're lucky, that first draft will get accepted. If not, it won't. So the last step here is pray. Please don't torpedo my rapidly written sloppy piece of work. And ironically, as I think it was Ben Franklin said, it actually takes longer to write something short and to the point than it does to write things that are much longer and filled with bullshit. He didn't say bullshit, obviously. So this is the wrong process. The right process looks like this. First off, that first half of the time that you've got is a lot of work, none of which is writing. So this is the preparation. It's the research. You start playing around with structures. What's going to be in the beginning? What's going to be in the middle? What illustrations might you use? Crucially, in this first step is a process that I try to help people to remember with the acronym ROME, that is how to get yourself ready to know what you're writing. ROME stands for four things. The first begins with R is readers. This is the audience. Who's going to be reading this? Because unless you know whether you're going out to orthopedists or landscape architects, you don't really know what level you're going to be writing at. But audience is something that everyone understands. The other elements you want to look at are the objective. What is it this writing is supposed to accomplish? What idea do you want to create in the person's mind? Related but not equivalent to that is the action. Now that you've created that objective, what are they going to do? Are they going to subscribe to the blog? Are they going to ask a salesperson for more information? Are they going to become educated? Are they just traffic that you want to monetize? The objective and action are something you must have front and center in your mind when you actually start to write. And this is where most people stop. But the last thing you want to look at is impression. I've twisted the acronym a little here to put the M in there. But the impression is, what do they think of you? So when they read this, do they think, oh, she's pretty smart? Or do they think, oh, this company really knows how to get to the point? This is where most writing that's filled with bullshit falls down, because the impression it creates is the person who wrote this is wasting my time, and that's not something that's going to lead to a further relationship. So going back again to this first step of prepare, you spend the first half of the time preparing, including doing all that research. Now it's time to write, and you need to find yourself a quiet place where you can spend an hour, 2 hours, 5 hours doing nothing but pouring things out. And you won't be interrupted because you've gathered all of the source material together ahead of time, and you know what your readers are, your objective is, your action, and the impression you want to create. So we write now. Your first draft is good, but you then immediately go on to the next half of your time spent on editing. If you're working on your own, you edit yourself. Every single blog post I write, I get to the end, then I go back to the beginning, because now that it's written, I know what it's really about, and I rewrite the opener, and I re-edit what else is in there. If you're lucky, you also have others in a position to help you. This is where you solicit their editorial feedback, but you maintain control of the content as opposed to just doing what everybody says. All right, I'd like to actually end with a parable, and this parable is sort of an illustrative example of how writing goes awry in corporations. And it looks like this. This is the parable of Ray's helicopter. So Ray is the CEO of a helicopter company. He started it with some pals about 35 years ago, and it's become one of the best helicopter companies, most prominent helicopter companies in the world. And Ray's chief strategy officer, who is one of his co-founders, comes to him and says, we should have a mission statement. We should have a purpose statement and put that front and center on our website. So Ray said, well, how's this? We make great helicopters. That's what we do. And the chief strategy officer says, well, that's good, but I think you need to think a little bit harder about it. So the CEO, Ray, then decides to go around and talk to his senior executives to find out how this might be better. The first person he talks to is the chief operating officer. And the chief operating officer says, well, that's interesting, but you've forgotten that we make a lot of our money and have a lot of our success from our incredible distribution network and also from our very lucrative service operations. So you have to include that. And as a result, he updates it to this. We make, distribute, and service great helicopters. So the next person he runs into is his chief financial officer, and she says, well, you've neglected the thing that's most important, which is that we make a profit. We're a really good company that makes a profit, and our shareholders appreciate that. So let's put that in there, and now we make, distribute, and service great helicopters profitably. So at that point, word is starting to get around that he's updating the mission statement, and he's visited by a collection of people. The chief legal officer says, you can't say great, that's a promise. You have to say something else. The chief product officer points out that they have a drone effort underway, so they can't just say that they make helicopters, but they're not announcing the drones yet, so they can't say anything about drones. And the chief marketing officer says, you know, our slogan is machines with edge, so we got to get that in there somewhere. So now Ray has updated this, and his statement is that Ray's helicopter, our global team, makes, distributes, and services excellent flying machines, machines with edge. That's the end of the day, and he goes home, and his wife can tell that he's not had a really good day. What's wrong? She asks, and he says, I have this purpose statement, and I'm just not happy with it. I'm not comfortable with it. She points out that that's his company, and if it's going to be the purpose statement, he has to be happy with it. And so he sort of tosses and turns and then comes in and calls all of his senior managers together in a meeting the next day and writes this statement on the whiteboard. Says, well, what do you think? At that point, there's a lot of fidgeting around. People start looking at their smartphones instead of looking at him. And finally, the CMO says, that's not really a very inspiring statement. And he says, yeah, I've got the same problem with it. How did we get here? I just took all your suggestions. Well, what do we really do? We make the greatest passenger helicopters in the world. There's a statement that everybody can get behind. There's a positive statement that's not overwritten. And the chief experience officer points out that this does not say anything about their customers. The sales guy says, oh, you mean the buyers? And the product guy says, no, no, you must mean the pilots. They're our customers. And somebody else points out that the passengers also have a great experience. Do they not know who their customers are? These are all their customers. They all have great experiences, so they add this on. For buyers, for pilots, and for passengers, the Rays helicopter experience is the best you can get. Now everybody's feeling good about it. Instead of just going and randomly pivoting a piece of writing in whatever direction the last person you spoke with asks you to, the purpose of all of this editorial feedback is to reach a higher truth. That's what editing is about. That's what writing is about. It's what meaning is about. And that's what writing without bullshit is about. And that's what you should be aspiring to. So, things to remember from what we heard today. People read on screens now. This gives them a very short attention span. You must treat the reader's time as more valuable than your own. That's the iron imperative. You must be short. You must be clear and bold. And remember to front load what you write. Those first 50 words should tell people what they're about to hear. And you want to build in the time to prepare and then write and then edit in an orderly process. But like Ray, as Ray learned, don't lose the soul of what you're writing along the way. Thank you very much. And I'll just tell you the last thing here. I am right now, the book will be out in about a year, so I can't give you that. But right now, I am every day blogging something significant at withoutbullshit.com. So if you're interested in this, just go and become a subscriber to my website, and I guarantee you fascinating content every single morning. Thanks very much, and I guess I'll turn things back over to Byron now.
Josh, really a fantastic presentation. I want to thank you for all that you offered to us today. I have lots of questions myself, and then we'll get to some of the ones. Let me quickly go at a few of them. Do you worry that removing jargon and keywords in particular, I'd like to point out, would hinder performance in the search engines?
Well, I'll tell you something. I've learned a lot about this from my own personal experience with blog posts and also from working with marketers. And let me make a blanket statement. Impairing readability in order to attract search engines is a waste. And the reason for that is that the way you get successful with the search engines is to have people link to your content, and that tends to happen because they find it useful and readable. Now, if you're in a position to look at two titles and they're both equally good and one of them includes keywords, you should definitely include the keywords. But as far as jargon goes, you can explain that stuff a little further down if you want it to be searchable on that. But you put enough jargon in there and you're going to have a problem. Now, if you're, I did a presentation once to a company that made replacement hip and knee joints. Okay, they were going to have the word orthopedist in their website, and that's excellent because it's designed for orthopedists, and the orthopedist should be able to find it, and Google should be able to find it if an orthopedist searches for it. So that's not really jargon for their audience. But there's a whole lot of other words that would make things a lot more difficult to read and wouldn't necessarily make it more successful in search engines.
Thanks much. I'll still continue to battle with you on that because performance is such a driver with marketing, but I'm going to let that go for a little while because I've got some other questions for you.
Okay.
Our customers at Writer Access, remember Writer Access is a marketplace that connects 16,000 customers with 10,000 writers, and our customers are desperately looking for all this content. I like saying, where's all this content going to come from that we need to fuel the content marketing revolution? You know, we need to engage our customers. We need to give them quality content. We need to give them tips and tactics and advice to make their life better, smarter, faster, and wiser, because we all know we need help on that frontier. And you're, to that point, our customers are ordering ordering content, for example, on Writer Access that are ordering it by the word. You know, it's sad, but they're ordering it by the word. You know, they're not. It's just how we have to, you know, work in this marketplace. We need to pay writers by the word. They need to be paid for what they do. Could you ever imagine another model where you could pay and compensate a writer fairly for the impact that we're going to have on their business, I might suppose, or the clarity of their writing? You know, how could you compensate people for great writing?
What a fascinating question. So you want me to solve the problem of your entire marketplace. Okay, let me see if I can get to work on that. I think that if you look at anything that's designed to fit into a spot, you have a word count in there. So, you know, give me 280 words that are going to be on our website, or give me a white paper, and I want the white paper to be 10 pages long and be 5,000 words.
Yep.
And I think that it's more a question of getting the clients to accept that if someone can accomplish that more briefly, they can do better. I recently worked with a local company here in Boston, a very talented woman who was writing a white paper for them. And so she wrote that, and my job was to go in and edit it. Now, I had structural suggestions, but a lot of what I talked about was cut this, cut that, cut this, cut that, go directly to the point. And it ended up about 25% shorter after I was done. That was fine with them. They were happy with that. People need to pay for writing that's effective, not for writing that's long. And, you know, the world of Dickens being paid by the word is a long time ago. Perhaps we should have some sort of performance-based pricing. But I do think, you know, if you can train your clients that shorter might be better, then you're in a position to get compensated for delivering what you were hired to deliver, not necessarily a fixed number of words.
Our answer to that, Josh, has been you get what you pay for, right? So we have a star rating system, for example, at Writer Access, where if you want higher quality work, it's going to have certain characteristics to it. And some of those characteristics, as you step up the ladder, are clear, concise, to the point, you know, a certain type of tone and syntax, and much more value-driven content that delivers customers what they're looking for. But the mystery is taken away because you need to pay more for that. I would also point out it's not just less is better, you know, or more is better. It's the fact that customers want better stuff within the boundaries of whatever the limits are. So, sure, deliver a 2,000-word white paper, but make all 2,000 words the best words they can be, you know, not the fluff in between, right? So,
yeah.
You know, there's nothing wrong with a book or an article or a 2,000-word white paper. If it's a great white paper written very well, you're not saying every white paper should become 300 words. You know, that's not what you're saying to people.
Yeah.
You know, it's tough. Yeah.
Yeah, look, and the editors I talked to this week, I have about 275 pages worth of material for this book. But I can't publish a 275-page book that's about being clear and to the point. It's going to be a 200-page book, and we're going to cut 75 pages because that way I'm not a hypocrite. So, and you know, we could charge more if the book had more pages in it, but I think people are more interested in quality than they are in the number of pages.
You're poking the bear yourself with your own problems. I love it.
I love it.
Yeah. Well, tell me about conversions, Josh. You know, do you have some science behind clear, crisp writing, you know, A-B testing and multivariate backup for some of the theories that really less is more?
I don't have data on that. I'd love to work with somebody to collect some of that on web copy. I just know that this is more of a not a little better versus a little worse, but qualitatively different. When you're looking at your inbox and you see something that just stands out, that's going to have a response, and that's why people pay advertisers so much or advertising agencies so much for really good taglines. So I'd love to tell you I have science behind this. it's more a question of passion and just general success. What I can tell you is that based on the response to my blog in the last 8 months, there's a lot of my fellow travelers who are very much believers that this has to happen. And they like cats that bring you little dead animals, they leave on my doorstep little links and say, Josh, tear this one apart. This one really needs your help.
Yeah, there's plenty of bad stuff to tear apart, by the way. I'm sure there's no shortage of finding that. One question I have is how can we convince customers and companies, for that matter, that we need more think time in creating great content? How do you budget for think time, and how do you rationalize that?
Well, I think it's a question of educating your customers about process. So if you say, you know, I think, and I've worked with clients and written stuff for them, and I think the first part of the process is what I call idea development. I was a senior vice president of idea development at Forrester Research for 5 years, so that means something to me. Mm-hmm. And this is where you bad ideas back and forth, they give you some version of it that they've written that you look at and say, oh, well, all right, well, we can't post this, but I understand what you're getting at. And if you train people that that's the first stage in the process, then there's sufficient time to prepare and then do the second stage and the results are better. If somebody says, you know, write this, you have a bunch of questions, you can't get started on it, then you're going to get a poor quality result. Because there's no such thing as a mind meld between the client and the writer that happens instantly. It needs to take some time to develop. Hopefully, some of your clients that are on the call right now can begin to accept how this is a very different way of thinking about things.
6-star orders, please. Okay, what's more expensive and more time and more tender loving care in delivering the product they probably want. But let's go to a question from Jennifer. Enough of my questions. Jennifer says, sounds like a pitfall in this approach is boiling everything down so much that you're forced into blanket statements like we're the greatest or we're the best, to use your the two examples. How can you, the writer, make a blanket statement on behalf of the average business like that when there is no way to substantiate that claim?
That's an excellent question, and I appreciate the substantive nature of that question. And the question, what I interpret that question as is, how do you actually get rid of weasel words? So let's look at two wrong alternatives and a right alternative. So here's one wrong alternative. We're the most powerful data analytics company that there ever was. Okay, well, that's probably can't be substantiated and it's probably wrong. If you start to qualify it, though, then you get something that's wishy-washy. We're an excellent data analytics company with many strengths. Yeah, well, that's not very interesting. When you want to get rid of those qualifiers, what you need to do is to remove them and replace them with something which is true but specific, as in, our expertise is in data analytics as it applies to medical data, or our data analytics tools work more quickly and return results 12 times faster than anything else that's available. So when you're looking to replace weasel words and qualifiers and you replace them with actual factual specifics, now you narrow down to statements which are a lot more interesting than we're the greatest. So that's the higher truth that comes out of trying to remove those weasel words, is to get to whatever is the best statement you can make that's specific.
Question from Alex. Great presentation. Thank you. Let me start with that. Over-collaboration is a killer. Everyone feels that they have a voice. How do you establish and maintain control what is actually produced? Tips?
Okay. Well, I definitely have tips on this. And I talk about this in my blog. It has to do with how you approach edits. So there are sort of three approaches that writers take to edits from other people. Approach number one is, okay, you want this, I'll put that in. And that's what results in that kind of overwritten
We lost you there, Josh. You back? Let me go to the office next door and see if I can help Josh right back at you, everyone.
Hi, I didn't change anything. Can you hear me?
Okay.
We're good. Okay, thanks. Okay, so the second approach is I'm the smart one, I'm the writer, we're going to do it my way, I'm going to pretend that I didn't see any of these edits. And of course, that doesn't get us anywhere. The right approach to an edit is to say, why did this person say this? I wrote something and he got confused, and his suggestion is no good, but I confused him here, so why don't I see if I can write this in a way that doesn't have that problem? Or there's three people and two of them said to do it this way and the other one said to do it the opposite way. Is there some higher truth that we'll get at this? Or I'm hearing the same comment over and over again, and I can fix that by consolidating three things in three different parts into one statement at the beginning. So the intelligent writer looks at editorial suggestions and says, I'm smart enough to know how to take all of these suggestions and come up with a better truth. That's the solution to coming up with a result that addresses the edits but doesn't end up as an overwritten pastiche.
Well said. I would add to that, writing by committee can work if necessary, but editing by committee can never work.
Yeah.
Food for thought.
So,
One person needs to control the tone and the style and the ultimate voice of the company. And in your example, Ray was that person.
Yes, I agree. I have
Ray just happens to be a CEO that's a good writer and,
yes.
and a good communicator. And I wouldn't say that with every corporate structure in America.
Yeah. I wrote three books. They were all co-authored, and the reason they succeeded was because each author knew what their responsibility was, and we had a common understanding of where we were going. The third book, which had three co-authors, I learned don't ever have three co-authors. That was a very, very challenging and difficult experience.
Speaking of books, the third book I wrote was called The Professional Skill in Writing Price Guide, and I'm going to give you a copy on the way out. You will be so wonderfully critical of this and find it fascinating. I took the same word count, the same example, and stepped it through multiple examples of this, you know, what you get when you pay more. And I analyzed the elements of each of those as you step up the quality of the work. What I'd love for you to do is say, hey, Byron, even your top-level $2 an hour word version still sucks. It still has bullshit in it, which I don't think you'll find. You'll see the exercise was both entertaining and educational for both customers and writers, which is why I wrote the book. But here's another question for you, Josh. How do you write short and bold without sounding condescending in the workplace?
I have to say that especially I used to work for Forrester Research, which is sort of an authoritative take on things. And now that I'm on my own, I have adjusted to be a little bit more humble, a little less arrogant, you might say. And I think that being direct and to the point is not the same as being condescending. So let's take a look at two possible approaches. Let's say you're talking about a problem, which is that a department is not functioning at an appropriate level. One approach is to say, well, look, I hate to bring this up. These are really good people we're working with here, but we have a performance issue, and surely we can work on ways to solve that. That's sort of cowardly, and while it is respectful, it's also, it's not clear enough. If you say something that says, I'd like everyone to acknowledge there's an issue here. This is what our performance is supposed to be, and this is what we're getting at. I have some suggestions on how we might improve that, but I hope that we can all get together and find a way to solve the problem. That's, you're not shying away from the issue, but that's very different from saying, hey, you guys are screwed up, and here's how to fix it. Okay, that's arrogant and condescending. So it's possible to be, it's more a question of being respectful toward the audience and using facts and not, you know, the padding at the beginning and the padding at the end and the stuff that doesn't actually ring true is the problem. I saw an article recently about when stuff goes wrong, like all these shootings that have been happening, and people say, well, our thoughts and prayers are with you. That's a good example of, you know, I think that's mm-hmm. condescending. That's a meaningless sympathy that doesn't actually mean anything.
We have a moment of brilliance, I believe, by somebody in the audience. Not kidding. I'd asked you a difficult question earlier with how can we justify higher pay with fewer words? And someone named Blaine had a fascinating point that I want you to comment on. He suggests, we'll still pay by the word, but use the meaningful ratio as a multiplier to get more pay. Is that brilliant or what? What are your thoughts on that?
I love that idea. And, you know, some people would say, well, hey, this is my proprietary thing. I hereby make this available to the public. Obviously, it's not some sophisticated formula, but anyone who would like to use the meaning ratio to determine how they want to pay people, I encourage you to do so. I'd love it if you give me credit, but yes, let's get that out there, and pay not by the word, but by the meaningful word.
It's powerful. Count me on board for some tests on this. The real challenge is selling it into customers, and I'm game for that opportunity, and absolutely will give you the credit. And more importantly, a link over to this webinar so people can understand what this is all about. Great stuff. Here's another one. Do you have a recommended blogger that...
Next question. Could you put Josh? Could you put the contact information slide up? I think it's two more. So two things. We've got another webinar we'd love for you guys to join us at next month with author and storyteller and improviser Kathy Klotz Getz. And that's the registration URL there. But more importantly, we've got just dozens upon dozens of questions, and we can't get to them all. So if we don't answer your question, you can email us. So I'll put all of that in the chat for you guys if I wanted to do it to give you that information before anybody hops off the call. But back to you, Byron. Sorry to interrupt.
Let's see. Do you have a recommended blogger that implements effective writing? Is there should people go to your blog, obviously, to look at? I would think so.
Who
do you think writes?
I'd love it if people go to my blog, and there's a very active commenting going on there. People don't always agree with me, but they always have intelligent critiques of it. And as I said, it's out there every day. The other people who I admire, one of the really the best is Ann Handley, who wrote the book Everybody Writes. Very relevant to the audience that's listening to this webinar. I encourage you to get the book and also to have a look at her blog, which is full of interesting stuff. And I guess the other thing, which is not specifically about writing, is the HubSpot blog collection is full of really fascinating insights, and some of which are about writing. They have a guide to writing as well there, and that's another resource that I'd point people to.
Here's a question from James. My challenge is to determine how much clarifying detail to include so as to differentiate what I am saying from potentially similar assertions. How much detail is enough without being too much? Any suggestions or rule of thumb?
Put it all in there and then cut 80% of it. There's a point at which detail becomes becomes an impediment. And it's obviously a qualitative thing. You feel it, but it's really one of those things that can be deadly. And when you cut, you have to cut stuff that you like and that you know is true. What I'd recommend as a trick there is, could you put it in a table? Could you put it in a diagram? Could you have a list of bullet points that people can skip the ones that don't apply to them? If you make it possible for people to consume those details in a way that's not interfering with the flow of what you're trying to get across, then you're a lot better off. But often you get into a situation where if you just keep putting all of that extra prose in there, it just slows people down and interferes with the point you're trying to make.
A question from Andrew. How much importance do you place on typography?
I am not an expert on design and typography. I think there are certain elements that are more readable, especially on screen. White space is crucially important. Anyone who's seen the diagrams on my blog, or for that matter the slides in this webinar, knows that I'm not a design expert. But it's if you can work with a designer to enhance the readability, you'll be successful. But the thing you'll learn as you talk with designers is that they're much more effective if you can write short. So it's a collaboration. You get them to help you, and you put as few words in as will get the point across.
Can you propose a better way to write executive summaries, writes Harold?
That's a great question, and it's one that I've thought about a lot. First of all, keep your executive summary to one page, page and a half maybe. Even in the longest pieces, that's the way to be successful. And one of the problems people have with executive summaries is what I call the food processor problem. They take all of the detail that they've got and they just zhuzh it all up until it becomes a generalized mush. So if you have five things then you're trying to summarize, it's much better to choose the one that's best and put that in the executive summary and say, you know, for example, this company did this, than to say, there are five leading companies who have implemented this, and then you don't actually get to see it. So you include the chunks of meaning. You're making a jambalaya in which everything has its own unique flavor pulling out there, rather than just throwing it all into a food processor and grinding it up into mush.
One of our questions, or one of our writers at Writer Access, has a great question. How do you discuss with clients who insist on third person when their content requirements are a formula for bullshit?
So I sense that your writer is really saying, it's not my fault.
Yes.
I have to write this crap. They insist on it. So I'm going to tell you, here's what I can tell you. This is not a very useful formulation at this point, but I originally was thinking about doing this book as a Kickstarter. And my dad had a wonderful idea for a Kickstarter premium, which is not to send a pre-release copy of the book to the people who fund you, but to send a copy to someone that they say needs to read it. Right? Like, hey, you really have to read this without bullshit thing. There's something you could learn from that. So I guess I can say point them in my direction. I got hired recently by a university professor who wants his department to write stuff that's more to the point. And he said, look, I know, I believe in everything you're saying, but they'll believe it a lot more if it comes from an outside authority. So, yeah, let me talk to your people or point them at my blog, and maybe we can change their mind. And if not, get a different client.
here's a fascinating question. There are companies, by Michael, there are companies dedicated to producing jargon, weasel words, and passive voice. They're called brand agencies. How do we help these organizations build entire brands without bullshit?
I would say that any decent brand agency is not dedicated to those things. And in fact, advertisers in particular have learned the value of more direct speech. So I guess I'm going to challenge what your questioner's question is here and say, if you've got a brand agency who is dedicated to those things, you need to get a different agency.
What is a good meaningful ratio target percentage?
I would say, well, 100% is not unachievable, because, you know, if you include words like and the that are necessary, you can make sure that every bit of text that you've got means something. On the other hand, something that's 100% meaning is like eating a meal that's 100% protein. It gets pretty significant pretty early. So I'd say probably somewhere around the range of 20% is usually connective tissue, things that you know, transitions, friendly introductions, stuff like that. But I'd say 80% is what people should be aspiring to.
Here's a question for me, and then I'm going to get back to a related one that somebody asked. There's a wave of storytelling hitting the content marketing revolution, as I'm sure you're quite aware. What is your take on storytelling, and how would your metrics line up with the average story that's told, and whether there's perhaps way too much bullshit in traditional storytelling, even as it unfolds into the content marketing revolution?
So that's a fascinating question. It really is. So stories that were 100% meaning would be pretty hard to digest. Storytelling is important because people need a beginning, a middle, and an end. But you have to balance that with the padding that tends to be in, especially the beginning of stories, where you're warming up and getting people to like you. The problem is that in today's content world, there's not that much patience for that kind of thing. The solution to this is to start your story with the moral, to start with the first couple of sentences. And that's what I do in my blog posts, which are all stories, but they start with a statement of two or three sentences which are intended to interest you in the content, as opposed to setting the stage in some sort of artistic way. If you're writing romance fiction, you can ignore everything I said. But if you're writing content marketing, give me two or three sentences in the beginning that tell me what I'm about to hear, and then you can start to tell your story.
James writes, why does writing about social media seem to contain more bullshit than usual?
As a person who wrote a book and many reports about social media, I'm feeling a little bit criticized by that. But I think here's the reason that happens, and it's not unique to social media. The ROI of social media is very difficult to define. And as a result, people come up with all sorts of metrics that are full of hot air. And I think that there's a correlation between bullshit-heavy content and people who actually don't have anything useful to say. So when you read something and you're like, I can't figure out what these people are getting at, it may be that they actually have nothing substantive to say, and they're just putting a bunch of words out there. Now, as I said, that's not unique to social media, but it is something that's associated with areas where the content is bullshit, not just the words. The solution is there are real things to say about social media, but the problem is that social media marketing, in particular, is full of all sorts of charlatans, and that tends to lead to bullshit-heavy descriptions.
Josh, I've spoken several times on the metaphor concept and its relation to neuroscience and neuromarketing, and have really done a lot of research, and this has been quite fascinating. Allison asks a really interesting question, and it is a metaphor. I'd love your thought on it. Allison asks, you know, if he thinks our thoughts and prayers are with you, what would be... what would, if Josh are condescending, what would be more appropriate to say?
Okay,
and I would point out that
there
is a metaphor. Yeah, let me repeat the question. So Allison asks, if Josh thinks our thoughts and prayers are with you, are condescending, what would be more appropriate to say?
Well,
and that relates to my point of metaphors. I mean, that is a metaphor. You know, thoughts and prayers are not with anybody, right?
Yeah.
No, it's a metaphor, and it triggers our brain in a certain way. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah. First of all, the reason I laughed there is because I thought the question was having thoughts and prayers that were with me as I undertook this goal. So the problem with thoughts and prayers are with you is not that it's a metaphor, but that it's a cliche, that it is meaningless. It doesn't actually mean anything to anybody. So when you read this in the wake of this, when you read stuff that is unique, it's like, I know the people in the Northwest feel things in a way that's not the same as the rest of the country, and I know this has to be very upsetting for them. If you just try to say something that's actually unique as opposed to picking the same thing that everybody else says, then you're better off. Now, I'm expressing sympathy is difficult in any situation, but I think that when somebody reaches for a cliche, you don't trust what they're saying because they haven't actually thought of something interesting and personal to say, and that I think is what has to happen best. So are we? I know we're over the 2 o'clock mark here. Are we have time for a few more, or where are we in this? Hello.
Well, we still
let's just do a couple more if that's okay.
Yeah, we still
have
a few hundred people here listening in. So if you've got time, we'll. Byron's got the questions.
I certainly would be happy to take a few more questions.
All right,
Steve asks, is content marketing killing the internet? I'm already looking for a means to escape.
I definitely don't believe that content marketing is killing the internet. Content marketing, in my mind, means creating meaningful, useful content that your customers will find attractive. And that's the opposite of killing the internet. That is making the internet alive. It's full of useful, fascinating content if you do that right. The internet isn't dying. The internet is thriving. The fact that it's full of crap is another issue. The thing you want to look out for is this sort of meaningless, unuseful, trite kind of content that some people are creating. So I think I'm reminded of Sturgeon's Law. So Theodore Sturgeon was a science fiction writer, and someone once said to him, 95% of science fiction is crap. And he said, well, yeah, but 95% of everything is crap. So the problem with content marketing is that just like everything else, 90% of it is crap, and your job is to write the 10% that isn't.
Perfect. Here's a final word to leave on. Let's see, Pam asks, legal review is where weasel words are born, in my experience. Do you agree with that?
No, I think weasel words are born in the hands of writers, but legal review is certainly a place that weasel words increase. I'll tell you something about legal review. First of all, lawyers are the only people just about whose advice you're not permitted to ignore. But when a lawyer says, you can't say this, say that, lawyers are good at keeping you from stepping in a hole. They're not good at writing things that are attractive. So you want to, again, search for that higher truth. How can I say this in a way that will keep the lawyer happy? And I've found something. I've worked with a lot of lawyers, some of whom I thought were terrific partners. And if you treat them as human beings, if you say, hey, I'd like your help with figuring out.
We just lost Josh there, and hopefully Josh will come back so we can say goodbye. While we're waiting for Josh to come back, I want to thank everybody for joining us. We had a great, fantastic webinar today, and really enjoyed everybody being here. Josh, are you going to bounce back in? Maybe not. Kate, anything else we need to say or do?
I think that's all for today. Thank you again so much, everybody, for joining us, for taking not only the hour, but beyond the hour to spend with us and learn. Josh, we appreciate your time as well. I've learned a lot. I hope you guys as well. And hopefully we'll see you next webinar, November 5th, writeraccess.com/webinar.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks, everyone. Bye. Thanks, Josh. Fantastic job. Really appreciate you being
Bye-bye.
Here. Bye-bye, everyone.